Great going. So let's start our second round, which is called Power Play. Starting with team two first, Vikram Lalwani. Most people will ask you to get a reality check. And by that I mean gossiping, carrying tales, currying favor with a boss, sycophancy. These are the essential attributes of climbing that corporate ladder.
I don't believe it. And I'm sure my colleague also does not believe it this way. Loose lips sink ships. That's the way I actually believe it. Gossiping, at a leadership position, one cannot be, at the end of the day, it's not only about an individual contribution, it's about a collective contribution of an organization at the leadership level.
And you certainly have not watched Madhur Bhandarkar's film Corporate. All right.
No, I have watched. Okay. I have watched and see what happened at the end.
Okay.
What happens is, if you don't stand
on any film, the good wins over the evil, right? So most of them, at least.
No, but that you actually came up with the analogy of corporate, so the good always wins over the evil.
Fair enough. Himanshu, they say office politics and playing one up against the other is a skill that perhaps in a very unobtrusive fashion they even teach you in B school.
I don't know whether you can call it office politics or not, but there is a way of maintaining relationships and managing relationships. And that's a part of working hard, and I don't call it working smart, which is very different from not working hard. It's very different from not really applying yourself to your job, gossiping. It's very different from managing relationships. And managing relationship is not just with your immediate superior. It's with people working under you. You need to manage relationships with them. You need to manage relationship with your customers. So you need to manage suppliers. Relationships need to be managed. In a family environment, amongst friends, in the corporate world. And that does not necessarily lead to sycophancy.
All right, Vikram. The squeaky wheel gets the grease. They say that in the corporate world, you need to blow your own trumpet.
Blowing your own trumpet at unnecessary intervals also is detrimental. When you have proved something, or when you have done something for the organization and the organization has benefited from it, and in order for you to impart that knowledge to the other people in the organization as to how you've gone about doing it, if you call that blowing the trumpet, yes, I would say that's blowing the trumpet too. But if you have to look at it from a flip side, if this is the basis for me to impart knowledge to my other peers, colleagues, subordinates within the organization, I think that's fair enough.
All right. Himanshu, yeah.
When you start your career, I think we are talking about when you reach a position where you're heading an organization. But when you start your career, everybody says visibility is important. And you need to define what that visibility is. My firm belief is that if you really put all effort to deliver the results, you will be very visible in the organization without really blowing your trumpet, as you're saying. You don't need to do that.
All right. Himanshu, since you head Landmark, let me quote Shakespeare, who said that it's dangerous to be too good. Do you think that those who work hard, who run that extra mile, who burn that midnight bulb, actually burn the candle at both ends, they burn out much faster than the others, and you don't climb the corporate ladder, you fall down?
It's very much possible. I think when you work hard and you work long hours and you put your heart and soul into the work that you're doing, there's every chance of burning out, and I've seen it happening to my friends. But I think, therefore, you need to have other things that you're passionate about. So, for example, in my case, I'm passionate about sports. Books, music, I'm passionate about, but that's a part of my working life now, so that's brilliant. But I think you need to have release mechanism, because if you don't have that and you keep working hard, you're absolutely right. It leads to burnout.
All right. Vikram, you know, there's this legal maxim. It says justice should not only be done, but also be seen to be done. Similarly, you shouldn't merely working hard is one thing, seen to be working hard is another thing, as in your boss needs to see you working hard. So you come in late to office, but if your boss is not there, and if you immediately send out 100 mails, then he says, my goodness, look at this guy, he's working so hard. No.
Not necessary, as long as...
as long as the boss is there before you.
It's not a question of, you know, I think in today's day and age, things have changed quite a bit. It's unlike an organization where one clocks in at 9 in the morning, clocks out at 6 in the evening. Productivity is not measured that way. Today, in fact, a lot of success stories actually stem out of the fact of whether I'm able to deliver to my end customer the kind of results that my organization expects me and hence the entire team to deliver. So whether that happens from 9 in the morning to 6 in the evening, or whether that happens from 2 in the afternoon to 7 in the evening, as long as my results get delivered for my organization, and an important part, in an ethical manner. I think that's the crux in today's day and age. If today I have about 20 reporting managers into me, and I don't keep a time check on what time they come in or what time they go out. Everyone has the balanced scorecard measures of effectiveness and efficiencies, which they've got to drive in the organization.
So 2-hour lunch breaks are okay.
Sorry?
2-hour lunch breaks are okay.
As long as you deliver the results.
Fair enough. All right. Himanshu, many people equate those who work hard with, you know, like a horse with blinkers on. They don't adapt to change. But actually, to get to the top, you need horse sense. You need to work smart.
You need to really work in the changing environment. To just give you an example, when I started work, and it's not so long back, when I started work, we used to have, for all the figures, there used to be these rule sheets, and this is true about all big organizations in the country. I was working with the Tatas to begin with. You had these rule sheets on which every month we used to write the market share data, sheets and sheets, with an FX82 calculator we used to calculate. Now, working hard does not mean that you stick to that concept of working harder on this, so then you will have 100 pages, 200 pages, 300 pages. When Excel becomes a reality, you start working on Excel. So you need to learn and change with technology, with people, with processes, like he's talking about balanced scorecard. That is something which we didn't know when we started. Okay. Now, of course, there is the concept of balanced scorecard, which lots of organizations are following. So you need to change with the times, need to adapt. But at the heart of the whole thing is that you need to deliver results, and that cannot be done by not working hard.
All right. So that actually is quite the opposite of what the dictum that they follow while evaluating answer papers. The heavier it is, the more pages you write, the more marks you get. Right. You need to be like a chess player to always think ahead of that next move. Otherwise, you stagnate. You just work hard, and without planning, without really that smart element thrown in, you stagnate.
It's just not about working long hours. It's all about, as I stated before, it's all about how efficient you are. It's how productive you are. And you, meaning not you as an individual person, but you as a leader, and hence your organization.
The ability to multitask is crucial today. So mere just hard work, bulwark, really doesn't get you places. Because gone are the days when you actually had to balance things. Today, everybody wants you to not balance, but juggle.
If you are, for example, aiming for the next position, let's say you are a mid-level manager and you're aiming for the next position, you need to figure out what are the skill sets required for it, which means you need to prepare for that, which means you need to start building up your skill sets to ensure that when the time comes, you are ready. That also requires hard work.
Companies are no longer sometimes satisfied even with 30 or 40% growth rate. They want more. Like Oliver Twist, they want more. So in many cases, they just want the job done. So they don't require people who just necessarily work hard. They want people who work smart to get the job done, not the hangers-on, the people who just remain there and just follow the rule book.
I think at the base of this assumption is that if you work hard, you're dumb. And that's not true. In fact, from the background, educational background that I come from, all those people were smart and they used to work damn hard. So there is no disconnect. And in fact, I've seen that if your capabilities are limited, you tend to also not work hard. I've seen a good correlation between the two. So I don't think that these results that you're talking about, you need to decide which kind of organization you get into. For example, I have worked with the Tatas for 19 years now. And I've worked consistently with them, different parts of business. One way of doing things is to, working smart, is to say, every 2 years, I jump jobs. And, or to get into a business environment where results are expected, but this quick turnaround, stock market impact quarter by quarter is something, yes, the pressures would be there, but there are groups and there are businesses and there are business entities which work much beyond that, which look at longer horizons, how to build business, and you need to align yourself and go and join those businesses where it makes sense to work that way.
Team one now, Vandana to you first. There are no shortcuts in life or career. Those who take these shortcuts may have a meteoric rise, but then they fall with a loud thud.
See, it's a marathon. It's not that, you know, you run fast in the beginning and then you burn out in the end and, you know, you won't be able to. Or, you know, the other way. I mean, you can take it slow and still make it.
We don't need Hussein Bolts in the corporate world, is what Vandana suggests. But, Sabita, to you, most employers believe that silent workers, those who work silently and hard, are the ones who can be relied upon.
Not necessarily, Sanjay, because we are not talking about the number of hours you put in at work or how, what sort of an impression you create in a workplace. We are talking about value creation in today's corporate world. So having said that, when you say value creation, it's about what value each one of us as employees bring to a corporate environment. And that is what actually determines your growth in an organization.
I remember seeing this work hard and work smart, you know, in gyms in front of the treadmill. Anyway, today we have bosses sometimes who are so insecure that they're also scared of their own shadows. And a smart employee is, it's a fact, a smart employee is often seen as a threat and difficult to manage and difficult to control.
I don't think he is, you know, a typical person who's scared of his subordinates, you know, he or she is not the same. So I don't.
Good company to work in, I think.
Yeah, well, to add on to, if I may, Sanjay, you know, today's bosses actually take pride in shaping their successes.
That's what all HR heads say.
No,
anyway.
Not.
All right, Sabita, to you next. In this swipe card culture, clocking in the hours is mandatory and there are no excuses. You have to put in those minimum number of hours, and just because you go and get some business outside, nobody is going to. They want you to do the work and do it according to what's written in your contract.
We're talking about flexible hours today at work. We're talking of a great deal of flexibility given the way technology is advanced and how we can bring out the best and how do you bring out actual productivity. Productivity is not necessarily measured by working long hours. Well, the nature of your job mandates that you put in about 10 hours or 12 hours physically sitting in there, then that's a different story. But today we're talking about people who work in, our employees especially, who work in from any sort of, any remote place in the globe, so long as they deliver what they're required to deliver.
Let me quote Parkinson's law for you. It says, work tends to extend itself to fill the time available.
That's right, yeah.
Right, so there are people who can finish that work in half an hour, but they necessarily, to create an impression, will sit there for 3 hours so that the boss sees how hard this person is working on that presentation.
See, it depends on what the boss believes in, whether it is hard work or smart work. So, see, if it is smart work, you don't have to, you know, stay at office for long hours, and, you know, that's what we're talking about, right? See, to me, smart work is nothing but, you know, you're available on a Sunday in the office if there's a meeting, and you have the flexibility of being able to go, to your daughter's, you know, open house meeting on a Monday morning, you know. You don't have to, because, you know, you're always connected. You have tools like, you have Outlook, you have, you know, you can take calls, you can work on your phone.
They say hard work endears an employee to all kinds of bosses. Hard working employee is acceptable to all, passes muster with all. It's like the universal blood O positive blood donor.
I wouldn't really agree, because when you're talking about hard working employee, you're not actually appreciating the sort of effort that the hard working employee is putting in. When we say hard work, as my colleague, my co-panelist here said, Vikram mentioned, right, they're not mutually exclusive. When you say hard work and smart work, you're only talking about how precisely you work towards attainment of your goals. You have your goal in place and then you prioritize. Most of us, I'm sure many of you will agree with me when I say we do have a to-do list in the morning, but sadly enough, at the end of the day, we realize that not many of them would be ticked off. And we realize that the to-do list becomes bigger and bigger. And when you look at the four-point quadrant on time management, there are multiple tips on time management, but when you look at those quadrants, everything gets into an urgent and important quadrant. And you're firefighting all the time. So it's those days are gone when you actually go by and believe an employee who clocks in longer hours or keeps sitting in and doing his work. It's about how efficiently you discharge what you're there to do.
Working smart, some people think, is seen as manipulation. Being manipulative is working smart. In Hindi, they say chalu aadmi.
I would disagree, Sanjay, because when we talk about working smart vis-a-vis working hard, if I take myself as a person, I'm only talking about bettering my benchmark with each passing day. I'm talking about how do I do the same amount of work much better than what I did it, you know, the last year or the year before that. Because end of the day, it's you and you alone who's got to complete your responsibility, your goals. And it's only you who can help yourself in achieving those goals. So we're only talking about using, you know, innovation today, using technology. How do you actually put them all on a spreadsheet? You know, let's say you're in an assignment where you're constantly interfacing with customers. Now, you could keep having a lot of errant customers who are upset with certain things and you keep getting calls or mails. Now, is it, you know, that you're going to sit down every day and type out a response for every single mail, or do you anticipate this well in advance? Do you prepare some sort of a questionnaire with you and have an answer typed out already in key documents, and, you know, take it from there and tune it according to the query which you receive?
All right, Vandana. To climb the corporate ladder or take the elevator, everyone agrees you need to be a leader. And to be a good leader, you need to lead from the front. We need to lead by example.
I don't think today somebody would want to put in 15, 20 years of work and then slowly plan it upwards. And I don't think that happens today because here everybody wants to work for a short span of time, make it young. You know, most of the CEOs, if you see most companies, for example, Google, etc., companies forward companies like that are or new companies like that are about 35 years old, 32 years old. So where do you have that kind of time to put in 12 to 15 years of experience and then move up the corporate ladder slowly? And it doesn't happen. And mind you, smart is not cunning. Smart is something which is you're able to do, interacting with people and, riding on their experience and things like that.
All right. At 35, they become country heads of companies also.
Exactly. Respect.
You will gain respect only if you practice what you preach. So you might work very smart as a boss, but you still expect when you delegate authority, there are several cases of generals who never fought a war and they delegate work. So you can't expect your subordinate to clock 14 hours when you come in and just spend 3-4 hours.
I don't think we're talking about people who expect the subordinates to clock 14 hours here. We're talking of flexi hours at work. We're talking of different, you have BlackBerry today, your mobile anywhere across the globe. We're talking about, just to take a cue from what you said earlier, today's bosses expect the people to work smart. And when we say working smart, as my co-panelist here said, we're not talking about being cunning. We're just talking about how you know when to say yes and a no. How many of us actually want to say a no and we end up saying a yes? Right? So we end up trying to bite more than we can actually chew when it comes to a corporate work environment. So I think it's all about being very realistic that this is what I can actually achieve. This is how much my caliber is. And if I need to do something beyond this, these are the sort of skills I need to do. And talking about leading by example, yes, I think today every single leader is expected to lead by example, and unless they do that, they do not get the respect of the teams. So whether you need to stand in the forefront and fight the war, or whether you're behind strategizing and guiding them on, it's about involvement.
All right, talking about the war, we'll return after a very short break on ASL Chennai Speaks Out Season 2, when we really have that battle of wits between both these sides. Smart is not cunning is what they say. Let's find out after a very short break. Stay tuned.